Hello, and welcome to Westside Community Church Online, where we're a spiritual hub for a great community. And thanks so much for joining us today. Our Young Adults Get Together is taking place on June 26th at 6:30 p.m. And Family Fun Day at Westside Community Church is on July 14th from 10 to 11:30 a.m. Our Adequate Small Group is meeting on Thursday nights at the church, and you're welcome to join us at any time. If you have any questions, comments, or prayer requests, I do encourage you to fill out the Connect card located in the live stream description. And I hope you enjoy today's service. Take care.
Now Good morning, Westside Community Church. Most of you probably already heard that. Welcome, everyone. I want a special welcome to newcomers. We're so glad that you decided to join us. My name is Pastor Patrick Hazelwood. If you are a newcomer, we would love for you to fill out the card. There's a card in the seat pocket in front of you that just has information about that you can fill in so that we can get in touch with you and bring you in the loop on what's happening here amongst us as a community. This is not going to be a normal kind of a sermon morning. We're going to be hearing testimonies. And the great thing about testimonies is we get to hear about what God has done in the lives of people. And so this group here is some of the group who went to Dominican Republic. I've heard several stories from many of these folks, as well as the other three who are on the team who are not here this morning, the other four who are on the team who are not here this morning. So Bert, Pastor Bert, his wife Donna, their son David, who is leading the Grease Lightning song, in case you're wondering, and then also Sarah was also there. And so you've heard a little bit from many of those people already because they've got to share earlier in the month as they came back from the trip. So that's awesome that we got to hear some things from them. And I've heard probably a few hours worth of stories, and we're not going to keep you here for a few hours, but we thought it would be good to just hear a little bit of what kind of has gone on in this trip. So I'm just going to get started, and I'm going to ask one question, and then we're going to pass the mic down, and everyone's going to get a chance to answer this question, and then I may, you know, if some of the stories are not long enough, I may ask some additional questions to draw out what happened and what God did during this time that they were in Dominican. So the first question I have is, what was the most impactful thing that happened for you on this trip? And Faith is going to start us off.
That is a super hard question to narrow it down to what was the most impactful. I think part of it is just being a part of it, of this whole trip. One of the situations, I think every day there was something, but one of the ones that stands out the most that really impacted me a lot was the day we went to the dump. We met up with a group that's already there. They're called CUPS, C-U-P-S, and I believe they go every week with this horrible looking soup, and we made peanut butter sandwiches, and we handed it out to different ones that we had met and prayed with, and also some other food. But this one particular lady, Yolanda, she just blew me away. Their interpreter had called us to either, I'm not sure if I'm remembering correctly, called us to come and pray or come and bring something to her because she was too weak. And anyways, while we were there, so several of us went over and she just shared her heart, and we could, and she was just crying and just weeping and just praising God. She needed some money to get to the free clinic because she didn't have enough money for the expensive clinic. She has a whole bunch of internal stuff going on. And it's really cool in how our lack of Spanish, we had the great interpreter, but we were still able to communicate. And she's just, grabbing our hands, touching my hair. I had it all in fancy braids. And she's just pouring her heart out, and we were able to communicate with one another. I think I'm skipping a whole bunch of the story because otherwise I'll be here for an hour. But anyways, we met her. I followed her to the front of a vehicle. She just had to go. She had to sit, and then she had to go. And she was just weeping. And it was just like God had met her right where she is at. And she was just praising God. And for me, just being a part of that was just amazing. Just blew me away. I'm going to stop there.
The most impactful thing for me was giving food to people at the dump and making them very happy. They were picking up garbage and putting them in bags. What? to sell, to make money.
Well, I would say the most impactful thing for me was, like, seeing all the kids and, like, how happy they were, because we went to this small village, and there was this one little girl, and we had some toys, and I gave her a toy, and she got so excited about it, and she went to, like, all of the other houses, and she, like, showed everybody, and she was so excited about it. And then when we went to the orphanage, once you got in there straight away, all the kids just gave you a huge hug, and it was so nice. And then they got so excited about bubbles when, like, here in Canada, not you wouldn't, the kids wouldn't really get that excited about bubbles.
Hello. The most impactful thing for me was when we went to the orphanage, and I was, like, shoveling this dirt to move it so they could put the basketball hoop up, and this kid came to help, and then he left, and I thought he just, like, ditched me, but then he came back with a wheelbarrow to make it easier and stuff. And then when we were at the farm with all the kids, I caught a lizard, and I guess they were scared of the lizard, and, like, one of them grabbed it and was chasing his friends around with it and stuff. So, yeah.
And so what I would say, for me, that was most impactful. So when we sang that song this morning, Waymaker, even when you don't feel it, he's working. When you don't see it, he's working. And going to the Dominican was a great reminder of seeing God work and move. So just in simple, well, in not even simple ways. So when we went to the medical clinic, it was not a planned thing. It was a surprise for that doctor. And when we arrived with a minimal amount of supplies, but we arrived with diabetic supplies. And the doctor came out and said to us, "We just ran out of diabetic supplies yesterday. Thank you for bringing diabetic supplies." But it was almost like it was common for her to have that happen, that of course God was going to do that. Of course you're going to bring those supplies today because God knows we need them. And that, to me, that was so awesome. And then another time was when we were downtown, just kind of, we were doing a touristy bit of thing and going from shop to shop. And we went into one store, and the owner of the store, he was an older man. And we were just walking around, doing our thing, looking at things and such. And he came to us, and he's like, "Are you Christians?" Right? And so just by our just presence and God shining through us and out of us. And we stood there in that store and we prayed for that man and prayed for healing just because, right? And we're just shopping touristy things, right? And it's just, it was such a great reminder to me, right? That even when we don't see it or we're don't feel it and we're just doing some touristy shopping, God is working. And a reminder that, to me, that why can't that be in Canada? What's so different about that in Canada? That when we go to the store and I'm shopping for shoes, that God isn't working and shining through me there and recognizing those opportunities and searching out those opportunities to share Jesus' love. And that I don't necessarily have to go to the Dominican to be able to do that, right? Like, I think myself, and I don't know if other people feel the same way, is it, You know, going to another country, sure, it's easy. I'm on a missions trip, and this is what I'm supposed to do here in the Dominican, but it was a challenge for me as well, personally, to come back to Canada, and what are you going to do there, right? And a reminder here, right, that he can work through us here. His power is in us as Christians, right? So that was really one of the most impactful things for me. And I think, I'm sorry, I'm talking a lot, but I think the other thing that was really impactful for me was for my kids and the team to be so important, supported and pouring into my kids there down in the Dominican. They were such, they welcomed and embraced my kids. Like, you know, these are adults, and you know, we do our things, and we don't necessarily, kids can sometimes be pains in the butts, for lack of a better term, right? But it, truly, right? Like they, right? Like they haven't developed all their processes and such, but you know, the team was so encouraging and impactful on their lives, even though they won't say it for sure out loud right now. I do know that, and I know that that impact is going to be there forever. So I that was the other piece that was really impactful for me.
Well, that's a lot of words to follow up after. man, what was the most impactful thing? One of the hard things was there was many of those types of things happening every single day that we were there. That seemed actually quite unusual. I've been on other trips and done other things over, you know, my life and stuff, and to have the level of, you know, the frequency of events happening that much over that short period of time was pretty intense. But there were a couple of things that really stood out. One of them was our driver, Pedro. Typically, the people that drive the vehicles and transport people around, they don't get involved. They don't talk to anybody. They just kind of do their job. And if you go to, say, the dump or downtown or whatever, they sit in the vehicle and they wait, you know, completely unassociated. And, man, his life got changed. Like, he went from being kind of like that at the beginning. Some backstory, the gentleman's Dominican. So typically, Dominican people don't get along with the Haitians. There's a pretty conflicted clash of, they just don't like each other, you know, type thing typically. And I mean, towards the middle end of the week, like his life was changed so dramatically that he was even engaging with the Haitian people and, you know, and he was being very, like, you know, loving towards them and stuff and reciprocating that. And, you know, that's just one example. You know, we go on missions trips and, you know, we're expecting to do all of these things, and then all of a sudden something like that happens. And that's going to impact the people that are there already in the Dominican that are doing the ministry, because now they've got, you know, this individual, he's like connected with everybody. And it was crazy. We turned him loose a couple times there, and he said, well, what do you, and he's never had this experience. He's like, well, what would you do? Where would you go? What do you want to do today? And man, he took us on a wild goose chase, and we came across people and situations that we couldn't even imagine. Like, he knew where there were needs that they were just unbelievable. And so that was, yeah, I'm just going to leave it at that one. That was just one of them, but there were some other crazy ones too. So anyway.
Well, I thought I wanted to be last, but now I'm wishing I wasn't. The thing that impacted me the very, very most in this entire trip was the presence of God. His power, his presence in everything. And it started with when Donna made her announcement here saying that we were planning this and asking people to go. She had mentioned it to me some days before that, maybe even weeks before, and I said, well, that'd be really nice. I'm not going. I'm not the least bit interested in missions trips. Never have been, never will be. Nope, not me. I'm happy here. God's got me praying. I'm good. Thank you very much. That Sunday morning, I was sitting up front. Donna starts talking, and I hear the voice of God. I've heard it before, so I knew it, right? He He says, I want you to go on this trip. And that in that instant, I knew I was going. And that was the start of that journey. And that journey, like Sarah also said yes that morning. She decided that she was going to say yes. Now, Sarah and I are prayer partners. We pray every morning. Bedhead and all, we meet on video messenger and we pray. So we started praying for that missions trip. We prayed for all manner of things. We prayed for unity in the group. We prayed for open hearts. We prayed for boldness. We prayed for protection. You name it, we prayed for it. The most amazing thing was all those prayers were answered. Like, all those prayers were answered. Not one remained unanswered, including getting the passports in time. All those prayers got answered. There was boldness in our group that you would not have believed. Nothing held us back. We were told when we went to the dump that we should, you know, not touch the people, or if we touch them, maybe touch them with the back of our hands or something, you know, and then make sure you sanitize afterwards. Heck, we were hugging people. You know, the boldness was incredible and the protection was incredible. And it was a wild ride all the way through. We would meet for prayer in the morning and devotion. We would meet for debrief in the evening as a group. The presence of God was always so strong, so powerful, so palpable. You could feel him. You could feel his presence there amongst us. And it all culminated in probably the most impactful things for me, which were words that God would give me for people. And I would go, oh my goodness, this is amazing. Who am I? You know? And then on the last, sorry, I was supposed to preface this with, there's going to be tears. And I didn't. But the final night, the final evening, we were supposed to go to witness to some of the street workers, sex trade workers. And we had gift bags for them, like blessing bags for them. And I had been praying over all of this, praying for our protection and everything, but mostly praying that God would keep us in his path and that he would open up hearts to hear our message and that he would blind the enemy to what we were doing so that we could go in there boldly and proclaim what Jesus had, the love that Jesus had, the everlasting love that Jesus had for each one of those people there. The place that we were going was the Sosua Market. It's Sosua Beach, and there's a market along there. And we had been there before. We had done, that's where Kara was talking about, where we had done some touristy shopping before. And we had met some of the shopkeepers then and whatnot. So we went earlier in the evening when the shops were still open, like around 4 o'clock. And I was praying all the way there. But just before we arrived, I suddenly had a vision. And this was a vision of angels dressed in off-white garb with helmets and shields. And they just lined up on either side of us, just like boom, 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 all along the way. And I knew that we were protected. I knew that God had made a way. I knew that we could, have an impact for the kingdom. And we got off the truck, and I told everybody, kind of had a rallying cry there, I think. We went out there. Sarah and I kind of stayed separate from the blessing bag, the distribution and stuff. We were off praying, off to the side. But even though we were walking around praying and not with the group, people knew that we were with them. They could tell. And people walked up to us and said, what are they doing? What are they handing out? You're with them. What's going on? How did they know we were with them? We weren't wearing our t-shirts, you know? We were just walking together along, but they knew, and they asked us questions, and we got a chance to speak to people, and I got a chance to give a gentleman, one of the shopkeepers, a word that broke him down into tears, which was just amazing. And we were able to do all kinds of things. The Spirit of God, the peace that was there in the marketplace that evening was astounding, absolutely astounding. We could feel his presence with us all the way. It was really remarkable. And when we left, we knew that we had made a difference. We knew that there had been a change in things there. But also when we left, we heard the next morning that literally all hell broke loose. After we left, and the angels in the presence came with us, cell phones got stolen. There were conflicts and struggles around and all kinds of things going on. And I just knew that the enemy had been held at bay while we were there. He had been blinded to what we were doing, but he knew he was blinded. He had been held back by the angel forces, but he knew he'd been held back. And when we left, and that left, he came back in to find out what the damage was, and he didn't know what to do because we had prayed that there'd be confusion in his camp, and there was. And that was another prayer that was answered. And it was remarkable. It was stunning, and it was incredibly impactful to me to see all of that because Sarah and I have been praying these kinds of things for years. And we know that that can be done here. That's exactly what can happen here. We can pray here. We can pray into it all. We can go out to Galt Gardens and not be concerned because we can be protected in the same way as we were there. The Spirit of God goes with us. It's the same Spirit here as it was there. And it's remarkable. It's absolutely remarkable. And I can tell you, there is nothing like it. There's absolutely nothing like it. When you are walking with God, you don't want to do anything else. You really don't. And it's a remarkable experience. But the one thing that I want to put across to all of you right now is that each one of you here is adequate to do this. It doesn't take a super person. We had children with us. We had children with us. We had people who that joined our team who were living there in the Dominican, had retired there and kind of gone, I'm just going to go along for the monkey jungle thing and whatever, but I'm not really a part of this. This isn't anything we want to do. By the time they were with us one day, by the time we were done with that, their lives were changed and they were on fire and they wanted to be a part of things. Everyone here is adequate. You do not need to be a super spiritual person. You don't need to be steeped in the word. You don't need to be a prayer warrior. You don't need to have your life all straight. You just need to be willing. You need to be willing to be a vessel for God to use. And you can do it. We are every single one of us adequate. And that's what I want to leave you with.
So some of the questions have already been answered. I think maybe Elaine has answered all three of the questions already, so good work. There's a couple more questions I had, but I'm not going to pass it down the whole line. But if someone has an answer to this question that they were hoping to say, then I'll just give you a chance. So I'll give you two more options for questions. One is, how has this experience changed the way that you live here in Lethbridge? And Kara and Elaine both kind of answered that one already. And then the other question is, based on your experience, what is something that you'd want to say to someone who's considering going on a missions trip? So would any of you like to answer that question? All right.
Well, the way it changed, like, me, like, living here is, like, it's helped me, like, it's encouraged me to, like, tell more people about God. Because before I went on the missions trip, I didn't really, like, tell much people. I just kind of, like, talk to the people about it that I knew at church. But like after I started telling, like after I came back, I started telling people at my school about it and like all my other friends that don't come to church.
Okay. One of the things is that lots of people there didn't have like that much stuff, like all these fancy things, but they were all so happy. It's like, why can't I become here and I have all these things and I still complain? And that I should just not complain because they're there and they're super happy. They don't have all that stuff. So, yeah.
So we were at the one dump there, and there was a picture up there. There was some little girls, kind of looked like they were washing dishes or something in the dirt. That was in the dump, kind of at the Batte. Like it was at the Batte, and it was really dirty. Like the ground was, it was kind of, but here they are, they're maybe 4 years old, and they were scrubbing the pots and pans like crazy, like just very diligently working. And when we were there, just everywhere in the Dominican, I was almost embarrassed to be a Canadian, because as Canadians, we're supposed to be known as being, you know, very polite and very friendly and, you know, type thing. And everybody that I came across there put me to shame in that respect. They would smile and wave. They would talk to us. They were like genuine. And it didn't matter if the person looked like he was in a bad mood. If you looked at them, their countenance would change. They would smile. They would wave. They would talk to you. And it was just like, wow, what happened? So that's been an impactful thing even for me. You know, I'm asking myself, like, yeah, where did I go from, you know, not saying hi and waving to people when you walk on the street or anywhere? And there, everybody does that. And some of the circumstances that we saw, pretty bad conditions under a lot of times, but yet somehow the people were so positive and happy and optimistic about the future, regardless of their circumstances. And that was just kind of an eye-opener. It's almost, it was like the opposite of here. You go in some of the neighborhoods, nice houses, nice cars, people are dressed up perfect. You know, their lives are just an absolute disaster on the inside. And there it was almost like the opposite. Everything was messy and rough on the outside, but on the inside, they were just peaceful, happy, and getting along, and yeah.
Were you reaching for it before?
I was, but I don't remember. I don't remember what I was going to say. I think going on this trip, I had never had, like Elaine, no desire to ever go on a missions trip. Didn't have the opportunity, didn't think physically I could, blah, 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 blah. And I'm just so impressed that God used me where I am at. And now that I'm home, there's just been so many opportunities because I never keep my mouth shut. And I was telling everybody where I was going and blah, blah, blah. And I've had many opportunities to share with different friends and coworkers. Different things I've done. The person in the grocery store when my hair was all in braids, like, oh, where were you, blah blah blah. And it's like, you know, it opened doors for conversation that I would not have had otherwise.
Well, thank you very much. You guys can go ahead and take a seat. So hopefully through that, the sharing and the testimony that you heard this morning, you see God at work. I mean, from hearing all their different stories, you definitely see that God has been at work in their lives, in the lives of the people that they touched in Dominican. And next week, we're going to be talking about being a sent people. So just as Jesus was sent, we are also sent. So that we'll have a chance for what your response or what our response as God's people will be in our sermon time next week. If you're new to church and maybe this is the first time you've heard about Jesus or about God being at work in people's lives and being active, maybe this is something that you need to talk about. You can talk to any of the people on that team. They'd be more than happy to talk to you. You can talk to me, anyone on the worship team, any in the leadership here. They would be more than happy to talk to you about Jesus and the importance of Jesus in their lives. So I want to now have a short prayer and then we will continue in worship. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for who you are, that you are at work here in Lethbridge, but you're also at work around the world. And Lord, I am so grateful to hear the testimony of how you have been at work in the lives of our team members, in the lives of the people in Dominican, in the lives of the missionaries there, and even the people who are retired, and the drivers, everyone there that you are impacting. And Lord, I pray that as we have heard of your story, we've heard of how you have impacted lives there, that that would change how we live here in Lethbridge, that we would remember your faithfulness, remember your power and the things that you are doing. Lord, I pray that you would give us eyes to see, give us ears to hear of where you are at work, and that we would be humble and bold enough to join in the work that you are doing. And Lord, if there's anyone here this morning who has never accepted you, who's never taken that step of accepting you as Lord and Savior in your lives, Lord, I pray that they would not leave here this morning without having that conversation with someone. And Lord, if that's the desire of someone here, if that's your desire as you sit here, then I encourage you to pray along with me as I pray this prayer. Lord Jesus, I have sinned and fall short of what I was created for. I know that. And Lord, I believe that you died for my sins and I can be forgiven. I invite you, Jesus, into my heart as my Lord and my Savior. Thank you for coming into my life and for all that you've done for me. Jesus, we are so grateful for the work that you did on the cross. And I pray, Lord, that this morning that we would not leave here unchanged, that we would do life differently because we know that you are at work. We pray this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
confusion I breathe in your truth, I breathe out all my fear, I breathe in your peace, and I'm coming back to life. I'm feeling hope arise because of you, only you, Jesus. And I'm leaving the rest behind. My heart is satisfied because of you, only you, Jesus.
Thank you.
my pain and the guilt and the shame. Jesus bore my suffering to the grave to make me free. Oh, the blood that was shed, it now flows to cover sin. It washes clean and purifies. In its healing crimson tide, Jesus, he took.
Message has touched you in any way, I do encourage you to fill out that Connect card and don't forget to check out our website at mywestside.ca. Thanks again for joining us. Take care.